it.
A company will always keep
customer service rule. You can't yell at the customer, obviously.
Day-to-day duties. So, daily tasks and to-do lists are so important in a business, and always keeping the employee having something to do next. You never want to have an employee just standing there. So making a to-do list or making a checklist, that can be like a cleaning list, or that can be an actual, like, here's what you're doing each and every day and each and every, like, part of the day. Special training is, there's alcohol and tobacco training, working in a regular, like, small business. You have to pass that test in order to actually sell alcohol and tobacco. There's a sting test that comes around. Those are pretty intense, but if you pass, you're all good. If you fail, you get fined. If you fail, I think it's 3 times, then your business is kind of in a hole and you lose your license to sell for a little bit. And then just like learning new roles with an employee is always going to be something for you to do, and whether that comes like out of the blue, whether like somebody leaves their job and you have to fill in for them and take up the special thing that they did, and you know, orders and vendors. There's obviously the daily orders of a business, and every single order comes in on every day at a different time, and it's never the same each week. And then keeping up with the vendors is super important, having a really good relationship, and just always being in communication with them about what's changing or what's like new, what's hot, you know, everything like that. Money. So, like in order to make money in a business, you have to be super good at managing your money and not, and I guess budgeting, but not overspending or even like underspending that can result in a bit of a problem. So making a profit, there's the price markups that every business does in order to make profit, whether that's like by 10%, by like 10 cents, something like that. Always knowing what sells and what doesn't. So that's also another thing that goes with keeping up with your vendor. Knowing what's super hot and everybody's buying, or what's like kind of fading out that you really don't want to sell anymore. And then things like lottery and gas are the things that don't really make a business that much money, and they're just kind of more of a nuisance really, but they draw people in. You know, people stop for gas and then you sell something else. Or lottery tickets, you know. Profit, so the gross profit and the net profit, both are, so I guess the gross is what you get overall after you take out what you've spent, and then your net is kind of what it boils all down to once you go and pay your employees, pay off different things, stuff like that. And then there's the taxes that all businesses have to do, which having a super old machine like the one over there was a bit of a problem at our store. People would press the wrong button, but at the end of the day, certain taxes, soda tax and all that, have to go to certain places, and when somebody presses the wrong button, that results in serious problems. Customer accounts, so like charge accounts and everything, keeping up a really good relationship with your customers to the point where you feel comfortable giving them a charge account can be super helpful. The people who come in daily for gas and just set it down, it's so much easier to just do that, get it out of the way. But with that, you have to have a really good relationship or you're going to get people who put stuff down and don't ever come back. And that's when things get really problematic. So, customers. So, they obviously play like one of the biggest roles in having success with a business. So, making really good relationships, like I said. Keeping the business as neutral as possible so that you don't, like if you're one customer but not the other. So, especially during times of political debate, it's super important to keep your business on like straight track of neutrality, because siding with one or the other can really get rid of some good customers. And a business's responsibility to the customer, you know, basic stuff, keeping the place clean so customers want to come, having good hours so customers can come into your doors, you know, charging fair prices and everything like that. So adhering to your target market. So the target market is a simple section of your overall market that you like really prioritize and do like extra special things for them pretty much. So that can be like keeping certain items in stock. For example, at the Seagull store we always have a good selection of beer because it sells. And same with tobacco. Because we have certain people come in like every day or every other day for certain things. like our deli items up top. I think those are probably our two hottest items. Always try to keep them in stock. And then the special orders, which again, customers keep in good relationships to the point where they want to, you know, invest a big amount of money into your business. This right here is an order that we had for a sheet cake. So being able to do orders like that and being able to like fulfill what the customer wants is super important to running a business. And then catering, and you have the ability, if you like run a deli sort of store and you have the ability to cater, it's a great option and it really builds up like your name in town and surrounding areas and everything. So yeah, keeping them in a relationship to the point where customers actually want to, you know, use you for food and everything. Advertising. Huge part of running a business. So, advertising locally can be anything like engaging in community events, so, you know, putting your name on a t-shirt and everything like that, putting your name out, like donating to a business or something, donating to a good cause. Assisting in local sports teams or departments, so that can be like sponsoring a sport, or I know Craftsbury has its annual, I think it's like a fried chicken situation for the fire department every year, and again, it gives catering and everything. Online advertising can be like email chains, which are pretty hectic, but once you get in the heck of it, you're pretty good. And then like social media posts, so we do a lot of those at Sea Village. We're posting things that look extra delicious on our Facebook page, so people come and buy it. And then knowing when to grow. So growing is super important to expand your business and to like expand the success of your business. You have to know the right time to grow and how to actually make that change. So knowing what's right for your business. So for example, at Sea Village, we had this really old register. We've now upgraded to a new one. And the whole system's a lot more simple, easier for training purposes, easier for selling purposes. And I think that was a good size change for us as a store. We didn't go too dramatic. We also didn't go too little to the point where it didn't make a difference. So making the right size change is super important when it comes to making your business actually grow. Making a plan, so, you know, getting your budget all set at the beginning of every year, getting it planned out, and just like having a plan in general is super helpful. Setting aside time to get everything done that you want to get done with your growth project is going to be super important, or else you're going to end up in a time crunch, or you're going to procrastinate it forever, and it's never going to happen. Getting professional assistance to know how to grow and when to grow. We couldn't set this machine by ourselves, we would have gone crazy. So we had to get a lot of help in doing that and making it all work and function smoothly. And then comes the next step, so planning like your next move and your next big change. And then I guess even reflection on your previous change and stuff like that is super important. So on top of all the stress of running a business, we get thrown into a global pandemic. That was very difficult. And a lot of businesses really struggled to stay operating and open and all that. So staying open safely was a huge thing when COVID rolled around, and businesses finding a way to operate in a safe way that made sense, that was effective for their like clientele pretty much. So making business modifications, at Sea Village we put out a tent and we did curbside only for a little while. But also during that time, we got to paint our walls and kind of clean up the inside a little bit. So it kind of gave us an opportunity to grow a little bit on the inside of our store. COVID relief, there was both state relief and federal. I'm not going to get too much into it because I don't know that much about it. But I think some businesses got more than others, depending on size and everything. But also, I think a lot of the relief came too late for most businesses in that, you know, they already had shut down and there wasn't really any way going back. And now with things opening up, it's hard to like start over the entire process again and everything. So COVID in a small business and how like having a small business in a small community affected like how COVID affected all of that. So that was a huge thing for us at Sea Village, and working alongside of our customers, finding out what's going to work for us, how are you guys going to keep coming in, and how are we going to make it all run. I think curbside first went really well. We switched our hours. And, you know, we made it all work in the end, and we're still up and running. So, got past that one. And then how communities help their small businesses and everything. You know, a lot of people went and, like, chose local. I think that was a great big thing that happened over COVID. So a lot more businesses got a lot more customers, pretty much. And then as for, like, businesses helping their community, these gift vouchers have been going out and about for months now. I don't know if it was since the start of the pandemic, but I don't know who organizes it, but there's a bunch of stores on it. They all kind of, you know, take part, and it's like a dollar voucher for, like, basic groceries. So, mental health. So the importance of maintaining a good mental health in a business setting. So it's super important to have, you know, either your boss or, like, the overall business owner, or even, like, the managers, being in a good mental state when running a business, because they're the ones who kind of keep everybody else in check, pretty much. So you have a bad person up top, then you have bad people all the way down. So you can always meet with a therapist. There's definitely certain therapists who are better suited to, like, certain things. So as a business owner, you can really connect with somebody more related to that field and everything. Picking up a hobby, you can start growing plants, as a lot of people did. And then just spending time with family and everything, and keeping family close, because stress drives things apart super fast and sometimes breaks it. And then keeping work life away from home life is another super important thing. So you walk in your door at home, we leave work at the door, pretty much. And it can be hard because work can be super overwhelming, and, you know, sometimes you have to take it home. But I think trying extra hard to leave all of your work stress at the door, and same, you know, vice versa, leaving home stress at your workplace door, you know, don't bring either one into either place. So my time at Sea Village. So where it all began, so senior project time rolled around, and I'm like, great, I've got a great local business, and I've got great people there, so let's make this work. And I decided to do something about advertising, and I chose to do, and it was our pizza giveaway, so everybody would put in an email, and then we draw them at the end of the month. This is Paige, she's great, and she would be my drawer person, and then the winner would get a free, like, large cheese pepperoni pizza. And the emails were used to put on an email chain to help with advertising and everything. So yeah, that kind of goes through all that. And some of these are posted up on Facebook to kind of get more of the word out, which, again, more advertising for everybody. In conclusion, so running a successful business is A, super hard, but doable with the right people and the right employees, the right vendors, and all of that. So there's a lot more than meets the eye when you walk into a business and just think about, like, what you're buying. There's a lot more behind-the-scenes stuff that goes on that people don't realize. So at the end of the day, everybody involved plays a super special role in making it all work, and, you know, the community, the business, the employees themselves, everybody has to come together and work towards a common goal to make it all work and function. Special thanks to Christy and Ipa and everybody else at Sea Village for making this project doable and fun and helping me with the last, like, 2.5 years of my life in general. We're excited. And questions? Involved in that process. So yeah. said is that, well, I guess first off, we use them for a lot of businesses, so places like the Outdoor Center and Sterling, you know, places that we know we can get in contact with if something were to go wrong. But I mean, I think it's just a lot of, like, regular people who come back, you know, multiple times a week, and who we know super well, and know that they're not going to run away with, like, you know, like $500 in groceries, you know?
And then I'm also curious, did you do the alcohol training?
Oh yeah, you have to do it every 2 years. I've done two of them.
Okay. So when I used to work at a general store, I'm very curious to see if this is still the same. I used to be able to say any excuse in the book if someone came to buy alcohol and we weren't going to sell it to them, even if they were of legal age. Is that still?
Mm-hmm. Okay. You can refuse to sell alcohol or tobacco to anybody. You should have good reason. You shouldn't just refuse for the sake of it. But it doesn't. You don't necessarily have to show signs of being, you know, under the influence of anything. Or, and if you're nervous, always ask for ID, like every single time. Because it could be a sting, and you could be fined $100. You know. So yeah, I mean, you can refuse to anybody. It can be a bit intimidating as like a young person, even like a young girl working there. Like at 16, that was terrifying. But yeah, at the end of the day, you always ask, you know, your boss, and they can be the ones to tell you. So yeah.
And then my last question is, I've always been wicked impressed with the relationship between the Village Store and the General Store. And I particularly love like the July walk party that mm-hmm. they both get together and create. So thinking about, ooh, there's another store in town. How do we cultivate this relationship? What was your impression of the behind-the-scenes work there?
So growing up, I always thought there should be a great big rivalry and like we should like butt heads. But now that I like have gotten into running the store and everything, like learning how it all works, I think having different options is a huge thing. They do a lot more of like the organic and stuff like that, and a lot of basically just like a lot more organic food. Not that we don't, but they like specialize it. We have all like the fresh produce and everything, and we have a lot more like the come in, grab it, and go. You know, with gas and everything, and like water tickets and stuff like that. So having different options and even different people, even you know, like employees, is a huge thing to making both of the businesses run effectively. I think if we both sold the same thing, it wouldn't work at all. So yeah, that's pretty much that.
I have a couple questions too.
Okay.
So how do you think you would compare like a super small business in a very small community like this to like a bigger business in a bigger community? Do you think things would work the same or do you think they would be different?
I think at the end of the day it boils down to your community. I think Craftsbury is super fortunate to have a community who's kind of all around each other forever. Like, everybody knows everybody. So, I think you kind of compare it like you would schools. Having a super small school, having the really good connections, having good relationship with everybody. Whereas in a bigger school, you don't really get that. So a bigger community, you would necessarily have, you know, the people who just walk in automatically have known you since you were 10 years old, you know. So I think it all boils down to the community and everything.
Oh, thanks. And then, actually, my other question was already answered. I was going to ask if there was a rivalry between the Sea Village and the General Store, but my question was answered.
So. We kind of make it up.
That's good. That's really good. That's all.
Any other questions?
Question for Christy and Meadow, which is, how did she do? Did she see it the way it is?
She did excellent. It was perfect.
I got a lot of intel from both Christy and Iowa before I like put all this together in my paper. Definitely long conversations, sitting and like writing word for word how each thing goes.
You got an insight on that though, because I think you worked and taught you how to do orders.
Mm-hmm. Again, it goes kind of like with the special training. We did our N&R dairy order, we all of our milk and everything, and I've never done it, but Ifa was too busy to on the go. So having that, and I guess it was a character trait, having like the mental ability to be able to jump into something and just like roll with it, you know, go super far in a business and like being an employee and everything. So, yeah.
Do you like win here or there?
No, not one day. But that's another thing that we do that kind of pulls in customers and like our weighing station and everything. People come and get weighed their deer. It's freezing cold outside. They want a cup of coffee and a snack, so they buy it. You know, brings people in. But no, I'd not have any fun doing it.
Oh, I have. Oh, go ahead. Did doing this project make you want to own your own business someday?
That's what I was gonna say. I've definitely thought more about business as a potential. Like major in college and everything. I don't know if I'd jump right into owning one right off the bat, but I think it would be super fun. Maybe not like a store in Delhi, maybe just like even like manager in like a bar or something. Something a bit different, but kind of the same idea. Yeah. Anything else?
Scotty coming too?
she nice?
Yeah, yeah.
Was she very overly happy in the mornings?
It depended.
Yeah.
It depended.
It depends on her first class.
Yeah, that's very, very
yeah,
true.
They could tip the scales and never have a bad day all day, huh?
It's so true. As much as you try not to let it.
Yep.
Wow, you can read me like
that.
Are
you going to introduce me? Because I don't know who that is, even though she works at school.
Saucy, but fair. Miss Crowdy is our music teacher. So she's a band chorus and a bajillion.
I thought I was Miss Considine or whatever.
She teaches French.
Oh, she looks like a music teacher.
Oh, well, they share the music room as their classroom. That's probably why.
Got it.
Like
my outfit?
Yeah.
I found jeans and there was a big jacket on my head.
Well, I'm glad you didn't wear those.
Your mom was going to ask Big Bruce and Mary Jo to cover for the last 2 hours of her shift.
They said
they
wouldn't.
They make her nervous. Mary Jo is just always crabby.
You did come! Hello! Hi, Scotty!
I told her you
weren't
allowed to come because you're going to make me nervous.
Oh, stop it.
That's hard. Yeah. They're recording anyways.
I got recorded on my phone to your mom.
She's like, I'm not gonna let him come. She's just gonna make him
nervous. I messaged Addie like 70 times, and I messaged Allie and Tina, and I called the house. And nobody answered.
I wasn't back.
I'm going without her. If she's mad at me, you don't work, and she's gonna answer me.
I'll let her jump on me.
That's simple.
Some of my things didn't have.
She goes up on the hill and
slides, I think.
We didn't see her for 3 days. She come down and did dogs, went on the hill, comes home from dogs,
okay,
went on the hill.
Let's see it.
Oh, yeah.
Like neighbors as well?
Yeah, she's...
She needs some.
Allie's a year old as Heather.
Yeah, that's
better. She can mentally set herself back into a 12-year-old and get along with her.
I asked
him,
he said he wanted to do her. He said he didn't.
It works out good.
I don't know about Lily's, and I don't know about Jeremy's.
Wait, isn't Jeremy supposed to be here right now? Can't make his asking?
Oh, I did ask him. He said he thinks about it.
Mm. Is he here?
He just left. He's walking right.
He was at 5 o'clock.
I thought he was the first one. He was
5 o'clock.
Yeah. Or, not maybe.
All right, my dear.
Wait,
okay.
Wait,
okay. Okay.
Why is this so weird? That's
maybe
you want
to come to our place.
What?
Same place as your sister, not answering the phone. Uh-huh.
When you're ready.
So for my senior capstone, I did had to become a tattoo artist and shop owner. My mentor was Corey, and that was rough. And then I also kind of had a mentor with Miss Michaela's cousin, Tony. He is in Pennsylvania. Yeah. So this is my overview. I have my introduction, which contains my essential question and what is tattooing. Then licenses and certifications, which is tattoo licensing in Vermont and shop licenses in Vermont that you need that are required by state law. Degrees, do you need an art degree or not to be a tattoo artist? My interviews is just Corey. Then I go over some of the more popular tattoo styles. Realism, tribal, new school, old school, neo-traditional, watercolor, and Japanese. And then things you need to know when becoming a tattoo artist, which is artist advice from Corey and Tony, and then the expenses, and then I have my tattoo designs that I drew. There's only two because I'm a perfectionist. So my essential question is, how do you become a tattoo artist and shop owner? What are tattoos? Tattoos are a mark, picture, or design in which ink or pigments get inserted into the skin. And it's like a very particular like layer of skin that it has to go through for it to take and stay and not fade or get infected. They tend to last as long as you live depending on placement and proper depth in the skin. So I have friends that have gotten really bad free tattoos and they are fading and they don't even look like tattoos. Licenses and certifications. What should I look for in a license? Basically, it's like if you go to a shop, you'll know like if their license is real or not. That's just an image from the website of Vermont. So a required Vermont tattoo licenses and certificates. You tattoo artists need to register with the state. They need to finish an apprenticeship, which contains 1,000 hours of apprenticing. And in that 1,000 hours, they draw a ton. They will tattoo themselves first after the mentor says they can. And basically why they do that is because they need to like learn the healing process and be able to watch it day to day. You need to take a universal precautions and infectious disease course. That's like a 3-hour long online course, and it teaches you about hepatitis B and C and why and how to prevent diseases from spreading. You also need to have your hepatitis B and C shots up to date for obvious reasons. You don't want to get either of those from your client or give it to your client. Shop owners, the only thing they really need is a licensing fee and a licensing registration. For degrees, do you need a degree to become a tattoo artist? The short answer is no. Tony actually said that if you go to college and get a degree, you could get better off with your apprenticeship because they're obviously going to look at that and you're going to have a stronger portfolio, but you do not need it. And that is a picture of part of a Bachelor of Arts degree. Interviews. So I interviewed Corey Jean. She works down the road at and owns Kingdom Ink LLC. She gave me my tattoo. Very, very fun experience. She's been on Ink Masters twice, one for a cover up, and I think the other one was on her knee or elbow. She definitely said it was a very fun experience for her. She's been tattooing for almost 11 years, and she apprenticed, I think, out of the state, I believe, is what she said. She owns her own shop, a very successful shop. She's always booked, and she definitely has a style for sure. And one of my photos is not showing, so that's good. She also runs a farm. Well, at least she did. She ran a farm for a while. She just had a daughter. I think she's turning 2 pretty soon, if not already 2. And she was my mentor, and she was also a mentor for a guy named Gavin, and she was mentoring him, and he was apprenticing her. And that's a lot to do. Oh, there's the other picture. Styles of tattoos. So this is a realism / realistic tattoo. These are mostly popular in people that want like memorials for their family members or their dogs or pets or anything like that. They can be color or black and white, and they're portraits and they look very real. This photo is from Realism by Ink Mag. They are a very good site, and I'm pretty sure they have a magazine as well. So they are a very well-known site. This is a tribal tattoo. It normally contains solid black lines and very elaborate patterns. This first came from like it came from the Native Americans mostly, and a lot in Egypt as well, because they just like very elaborate things. This is New School. It's very weird. It's very different. It's basically an animated aesthetic, which means that it's like animated characters, and it's kind of pleasing to look at. They are very cartoonish and wacky, as you can see, and they tend to be caricatures or weird made-up animals. Like Gavin did a tattoo that was like an octopus with a dog head. That was very weird. Most of the time they are in color, but they can be in black and white. Neo-traditional. This is probably one of my favorites. The first time I saw Neo-traditional was actually on Ink Masters. I think I watched every season of every different kind I have. Didn't know Corey was on it, so she told me. Didn't realize it was her because she was so young. So neo-traditional contains very sharp line work, vibrant colors, and they are also black and white. They're like a mix of both. They have very good illustrated quality, and they have a lot of attention to detail. Old school, they have very bold lines, bright colors, and they normally consist of roses, anchors, and female heads, just because that's what that era was like all about, was like worshipping women and weird animals that were of power, and roses are just a thing to have to use, I don't know why. This is watercolor. This is probably one of my favorite kinds of tattoos, just because they're so like natural looking, I guess. Not natural looking, but it literally looks like a piece of art on your body. And they don't normally have very defined black lines, and they always have very like a lot of colors. This was the picture I chose because it shows a variety of different ones. But there's one that's a dog paw print, and it's like it looks like paint was splattered on their skin. And it looks absolutely beautiful. And this is the last one. This is Japanese. Japanese X is very interesting. They still do their tattoos the traditional way. And I think it's a piece of bamboo with needles on the end. And they like hit the bottom of the stick with like a hammer or something. And it goes into the skin. And it's very hard to learn because it's not a tattoo and you're smacking into somebody's skin. So it's very hard for it to go into where it needs to go. It normally consists of dragons and other mythical creatures, koi fish, Japanese flowers, very common, and they always have very bold, bright colors. Things you should know. Advice from tattoo artists. Most of this is from Tony. Some of it is also from Corey. So find your strong points and continue to grow in them. I'm really good at drawing houses, which nobody is tattooed, but I'm also really good at drawing flowers. Don't know why you're gonna tattoo a house, but whatever, that's your thing if you want. I like floral designs. I'm pretty decent at drawing flowers, so I draw those a lot. I met Corey. She's really good at flowers. She's really good at the lace stuff. So she obviously specializes, but does more of that. Be prepared to hear no a lot. Pretty much what this means is when you go and try to do your apprenticeship, be prepared to hear no from a lot of places because a lot of people don't like to be the mentor for apprentices because it takes a lot of work and some people just do not like training. Do not give up. This one's really big because being an apprentice is really hard and an upcoming tattoo artist because you're not very known, you're not making money during your apprenticeship, and you basically are working two jobs to be able to like keep living and pay your bills and all that stuff. When you go to your apprenticeship, you should have a very strong portfolio. So like if I ever decided to go into tattooing, I would bring all of my designs and make a very, very strong portfolio. I would have whatever recommendations I could from like my art teachers and stuff, if I have any. Do your research on the shop that you plan to work at or apprentice at, because sometimes they're just not good shops. There's some shops that are just really bad and get really bad tattoos, and you don't want a bad tattoo. And you don't want to be a good tattoo artist at a bad shop because you're not going to get the clientele you want because they're going to think you're bad. Draw constantly, so this kind of goes with the find your strong points and you continue to grow in them. I draw, like I said, I draw all the time, so expenses and fees. So you have a decent amount of fees to pay as a tattoo artist. You have to pay a register fee to the state, a renewal fee every 2 years. The tattoo owner has to pay a renewal fee or a licensing fee every 2 years. All those consist of $250. And if you do not own your own shop and you work at a other shop owned by somebody else, you have to pay a chair fee. Kind of like at a hair salon, like you have to rent out your space. And those can range from $250 to whoever, who knows how much, because some places are really expensive. My citations. Yeah. concerns. Hopefully no concerns, but.
Yeah, that's great.
So Heather, have you actually done a tattoo on someone?
No, I'm not legally allowed to do that.
Right. So you would have to get.
I'd have to get 1,000 hours of apprenticeship and
wow.
get my licensing fee and my registration fee. And it's definitely a lot of work.
Right. But could you show, like, do a sketch and show it to someone and say, what do you think about this?
Or yeah, I'm actually getting both of those tattoos that I drew eventually when I can get appointments and have the money to. So.
Cool. Very nice.
Any other questions? Phoebe, do you have a question?
No.
So I'm really curious about if someone gets a tattoo, what is the place on their body that's going to get the least wear and tear? So I know, for example, like you really don't want to get finger tattoos.
Mm-hmm.
You constantly
wash
them. There's friction, you're washing them.
So pretty much, like when I got my tattoo before, you said like keep it out of the sun as much as possible. So like the places that would probably be the best this summer for it, your skin isn't showing all the time in the sun. And like feet are really bad, your hands are really bad, your face because, you know, all those oils and the sun is literally always on it. Yeah. Any other questions?
I have a couple things.
Okay.
First of all, I love tattoos. I have 4 of my own. And I also love watercolor. I have this one on my ankle that I love.
Oh, that was cool.
Yeah. I love tattoos. Okay. So you mentioned that a lot of tattoo artists have their own styles.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think, like, when going into an apprenticeship, it's important to like kind of emphasize on that style, or do you think you should be showing off that you can do lots of different styles?
So I think when you do it, you should definitely like not emphasize on your style, but continue to do it, but also be able to do other things because people are going to want you to give them their tattoo, but they're not going to want your style necessarily.
Okay.
And like when you're picking your mentor, you should definitely pick someone that kind of does the same style as you, but can also teach you those other styles. So that way you can learn how to do them.
Do you think you have your own style?
Yes. I'm very much like floral tattoos. I plan to get quite a few tattoos. I have 5 in mind right now, so. Definitely a lot of tattoos in the future. Anything else?
If somebody asked you to do a tattoo in the spot you know is going to be very sensitive, what would your advice be to them?
I hope you have a high pain tolerance because it's going to hurt. Like my mom had a tattoo on her foot, and I know that one hurt a lot, but her pain tolerance is also extremely high. So it really depends on your pain tolerance to tattoos. Like, mine was not that bad, except for when she did my shading, and my legs were twitching out. But I think I have a decently high pain tolerance, so. Mm-hmm. Phoebe.
Okay. In a perfect world, you're like a star tattoo artist, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got your own place, doing great, business is booming. Somebody comes in, and they want to tattoo, like, their boyfriend's name. Do you do it?
We've
been together, like, 6 months.
I personally would not give them that tattoo, because my uncle had 1 or 2 girls' names on him, and they are both covered. One of them was a big Lisa on from shoulder to shoulder,
wow.
And it's now covered with, I think, roses and stuff. That was like 4 like all day sessions. So I would not like, but like you're like my aunt, and you've been married to the same person for
right,
15,
yeah.
20 years, and you want like she has Jeremy on her ring finger because she doesn't want to wear a ring and she always loses it, and she's very rough on her hands. Then probably yes.
Okay.
So because I don't know anything about this, I'll ask this question. Do they give you a shot of Novocaine or anything before they do this?
Nope. You can ask for like numbing cream, I believe, but they do not. It really depends on your pain tolerance. Some people like the pain, some people don't like the pain. I'm one of the weird people. I love the pain of them. Sounds really weird. It's like an adrenaline kind of thing. I love it. That's why I want to get warm. So, but no, they do not give you Novocaine or anything like that. It's really funny because I have a really low pain tolerance. So my very first tattoo was on my back and it took an hour and 45 minutes and I cried the whole time. I was 18 and he kept asking me if I wanted to take a break, but I knew if I took a break I would never let him start again. So I was like, you just have to finish it.
Yeah, when I got mine, I'm like deathly afraid of needles. Like I hate getting shots. They're my least favorite thing, so I was like, tattoo needles, but I really want a tattoo. And like I got mine and I just kinda like played on my phone the whole time trying to distract myself, but like I thought it was cool. I've grown up around people doing tattoos my entire life. My mom's ex-boyfriend used to do them, Heather used to do them some, a bunch of their friends used to do them. So they would all, I grew up around a lot. I'd stay up to like midnight watching somebody getting a tattoo, so it was definitely part of my childhood.
I think it's a lot different than getting a shot too, because I mean for me anyway, it was more just like it looked like somebody was drawing on me. It didn't look like a needle going through my skin.
Yeah, because it literally goes in like
that
much, and you don't really, you feel it, but it doesn't hurt me really as much to me anyways. Miss Miller, you have a question?
It's for Jacob actually. Jacob, now that you've seen this presentation, would you let her tattoo you?
No.
I wouldn't let me tattoo myself.
She'd get like arrested or something.
Anything else? Dominique, do you have a question?
Where would you say is the place on the body that would hurt the most?
Anywhere where there's not a lot of fat. So your face, your ankles, your fingers, your ribs, your sternum, your spine. Like right here on the wrist, probably already said that.
Your calf muscle.
Huh. Your calf muscle. Mm-hmm. I'm planning on getting one of the ones that I showed there. But yeah, my dad has 3 tattoos. I don't know how many you have.
Almost 10.
Yeah, my mom has a full sleeve on this side. I think she has a full sleeve on this side, or like almost full sleeve on one side. She has one on her shoulder, she has 2 on her calf, she has one on her foot, she has one on her thigh. I'm probably forgetting one other one. I did that one. So, my aunt has 2 tattoos. A lot of my family has tattoos. My uncle has 2. And then my other uncle has a lot. He has one right here, I believe. Or it goes like down and comes down his hand. He said it was very painful. And he has really high pain tolerance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bibi?
So what do you think about like all the stigmas that come with tattooing, like people who are tattooed and like, well, you know, some businesses won't hire people with tattoos or like visible ones at least, and like you see a guy walking down the street covered in tattoos and you can be kind of
like stereotype kind of thing.
That? Yeah.
I definitely think stereotypes that come from specifically people that have a lot of tattoos are very I don't want to say stupid, because stupid isn't the word, but I think it's like very unnecessary. Just because somebody has tattoos, it's not, they're not a bad person. My mom has friends that have tattoos all over them, and they are probably some of the nicest people I've ever met. But I do get where people think that people with tattoos are bad people, because a lot of people get tattoos in jail and get covered in them, so I kind of see where that comes from, but I just think it's kind of like a unnecessary stereotype.
Yeah,
like a lot of the other stereotypes in our world.
Okay. Do you think all of your tattoos need to have a meaning?
Personally, no. My first tattoo has a meaning. It's for my grandmother. She got a cancer 3 or 4 years. I lose count. So. It's going to be 3 in December.
You guys heard that, right? Graduating Friday, you can't do math.
I'm general applied math. I'm learning how to do all over again. It's fine.
I love
it. But like the 2 flower drawings that I did that I want to get do not have meaning. I'm getting my last name somewhere in my body. I don't know where yet. That obviously has meaning because it's my last name. And then I'm getting a tattoo for women empowerment. Don't know where that one's going yet either. And then I'm getting my dog's paw print. That has meaning. It's my dog. I want to get it before he dies. he's only two, so I got a ways, but I'd rather have it now than.
That's a big problem.
It is. It's like. Yes.
I guess something that's always been really interesting to me is how Corey mixed her sister's ashes with the tattooing.
Mm-hmm.
She tattooed on her skin. So I'm really curious, impact the quality? Are there other things you can add to the ink? Like, that's really interesting to me that worked.
I think I don't really know how it works, but I didn't do much research on it. I think I read like one article about it, and it wasn't a very long one, or very informative. I think they just kind of like sprinkle some in the ink and like stir it or something, and it just kind of like dissolves into it. I don't think it really affects the quality of the tattoo.
Okay.
Any. Some people like to do that. I think it's weird. But that's just me.